The goal really today is to explore the challenges in the industry of healthcare. I'm primarily going to be focusing on the physician side of the challenges and then some of the patient side, but primarily the physician outpatient side. Three topics that I'm going to be going over. One is today, how healthcare is today. I'm going to go over a bunch of stats. I'll fly through them really fast. And then I'm going to talk about the future. That's the fun part of my talk. So just jumping in, I always put this up first just to remind us of where we all kind of came from in the past. Physicians used to have a handbag, right? And they had all of their tools in this bag. And they would walk to someone's home and take care of that person in their home. And really, healthcare has changed a lot since that provider-patient experience from the past. I put this image up here, and this is really what it is today. This is the state of healthcare today. It's a lot of separate buildings where people are doing a lot of work and they may not actually be communicating with each other. You have one hospital not communicating with another hospital, not communicating with an outpatient doctor, not communicating with the nursing home, not communicating with another institution. So there's a lot of disparate health institutions out there not sharing their data. So me and my co-founder kind of talk about things like this a lot, where we kind of view it like silos, farm silos, where people are not communicating at all. So there's a lot of unknown happening between the patient. It's a secret also in the industry where the industry kind of runs on fax machine a lot of the time. So a lot of providers and hospitals and physicians are actually just faxing things back and forth. So this is kind of what a provider is today. And we had one provider come into our offices at our company, and the provider said, I'm kind of a glorified assistant. I'm just taking and paper pushing as much as possible. So there's a lot of problems. But really at the end of the day, when you think about healthcare, like what really, really, really matters? It's the time the doctor spends with the patient and the actual care that the patient gets with that time with the doctor. Again, I just want to make it clear, this is what healthcare feels like today. I put this up here. Does anybody know what a HIC for 1500 is? Raise your hand if you do. Anybody? Okay, so that's like five people. This is how doctors get paid. You can either do this digitally or you could do it on paper. This is how they fill out a paper form to get paid by an insurance company. Imagine doing all this on paper. This is actually a piece of paper that I got from a doctor. It was actually a hospital, and the hospital gave me a piece of paper to pay them. And they spent how much money? $50 million on software, and I get this. Here's a receipt that I got from a provider. I didn't get it digitally. So there's a lot of confusing parts to healthcare, and there's a lot of different moving parts. So the providers themselves are really in a conundrum where they're trying to figure out how to take care of their patients, but also be part of this like very complex system. Anybody here know what a cow is? Raise your hand if you do. Okay, that's like 30% of the crowd. That's a cow. It's actually not a cow. That's a cow on wheels. But this is actually what most of healthcare is today for the provider. Now we went from that handbag all the way into this right here. Right? So now providers can't quite leave. They're tied to this cow, and a cow is really a computer on wheels. So this is what healthcare is today for providers. This was on Instagram. I just took a screenshot of it. But you can see it there. It's essentially a cow. There's some more cows, just to make it clear, so you guys know what it is. But really, that's what we're all experiencing, right? You go to a provider, you go to them, and they're tied to that machine to document. Or they have a scribe or a medical assistant. And everyone in this room should really think about, how do we remove the cow so the provider can take care of the patient and not be tied to a machine? Here was an email from one of my providers. It was on a secure email, so it was secure, HIPAA compliant. But they were like, my EHR doesn't quite let me enter as much as I want if you enter too much text, but I need you to fill out this form. Maybe you could send it to me on Google Drive or a USB or email it to me. And this is a piece of software that I would say was probably the base install was like 50 million. Why am I getting this for like a piece of software that an institution paid that much for? And the provider is really just trying to get the information from me. They're doing their best job. I would say a lot of healthcare is learned helplessness. It's kind of sad, the way that healthcare is today. There's a lot of people with like, that's the way it is, just accept it. And I think everybody at this conference really kind of doesn't think that way. You guys are all here trying to, honestly, you're trying to change the world. So, you know, at this conference, I feel a lot of let's see what's out there. Let's see how we can actually do something really meaningful and impactful. This is kind of what I envision as part of our future. And this is really a screenshot that a provider had given me, one of our providers. He really wanted to project his surgeries onto the wall while he was doing them, while using an iPad. And he did. So he could actually see in real time the medical record on the wall while he was doing the surgery. Pretty awesome to see like doctors figuring it out on their own. So at the end of the day, technology should serve healthcare, not the other way around, where slaves to the technology. So how do we fix this problem? This is kind of the way I see the industry, and this is the way it's going to happen for forever. There's something called the S curve, and it's an innovation curve where you spend a lot of time at the base trying to figure out what to do. And then you get mass adoption of something. And then that adoption kind of wanes away at the top. And really, this is kind of where I see healthcare, with a bunch of S's, right? So you had paper, it kind of came out, it was like revolutionary. People were writing books, they could disseminate, you know, place on all of this information as fast as possible. And then something else came along. Really, really large servers kind of changed the game. People could do like a lot of interesting things with these servers. And then the floppy disk came around where you could actually, remember when you could take that information with you, it was like, oh my God, this is crazy. And then CD. But I would say the revolution that's happening today is really around cloud, where there's a lot happening and it's a complete renaissance happening. I've heard this one quote, software is eating the world, meaning there's a lot happening with software. And there's also a revolution with phones and other devices that's happening. And I see these as S-curves, where they're kind of in like the really rapid adoption phase of these types of devices. I'll just talk about the history of our company a little bit, so you see where I'm coming from and where we're trying to take our company, and then I'll give you a larger perspective on like some of the where I see healthcare is going. Our company started out of Stony Brook University on the East Coast. It was started with me and my co-founder back in 2002. We met in college and in a dorm. We were two software developers. And for me, when I came into healthcare, it really had to do with my family. I wanted to manage my parents' medical records digitally, and it just wasn't there in 2008. So when you want to take care of your parents, I wanted to do something about it, and I felt like there was a need. That's me and my co-founder. We started 2008, incorporated the company in 2009. We got our first paying user. It was actually we were going door to door to providers. We were talking to hospitals. We were trying to understand, like, what do providers want? And we kept asking ourselves, what do providers actually need? And we found these two providers, and they were explaining to me how horrible it was to deal with all of the paper. They had a whole wall of paper, and they were just dealing with paper day in and day out. And they told us that they would pay for software that could manage all of their patients and make their lives easier. So it was Dr. Goldberg and Dr. Kroner, two providers in New York City who use our software still today. So our mission was really to enable the clinic of the future through technology. We basically are building a medical platform for all specialties, so any specialty can go on and use the software. And this is really what we do. We do medical records, we do medical billing, we have RCM, we have access for patients, we have an API and an apps. And really, we wanted to have a really big, broad reach to make an impact in the world. We all have that device in our pocket, and we're using it more and more. At the core of, like, our company, and I think this is something your company should really think about, is how do you actually make that device usable for the provider? So we took the full medical record, full practice management software, and placed it onto the iPhone. A lot of medical companies are not doing this. They should be doing it because the phone is, like, in my pocket right now. And if there's an emergency, isn't it nice to call your doctor when they're golfing or when they're home or when they're with their kids to, like, let them prescribe a drug for you right there? So we built a full platform, web, iPad, iPhone. We even have a watch app. The user experiences the full, I would call it, care journey, where you have the patient, they can book their appointment from home, they can view information from home, they can fill out all of their forms from home. There's the patient check-in. That's the point where the patient is in the waiting room and they can fill out all their information. We also have the care app for the providers, and of course, the billing side as well. Those are the apps. I kind of threw this up here for fun. We're part of Apple's, called the MPP program, Mobile Partnership Program. How do you allow a doctor to chart and see a patient with as few taps, as few clicks as possible? I'll give you guys some statistics now on our company, and then I'm gonna go into just general statistics across the industry. In Dr. Chrono, a startup, we have 17 million patients in the software. It blows my mind how fast our company has grown. It's just from better design, less taps, less clicks. There's no secret. So you take the number of patients in Dr. Chrono, divide that by the US population. So how many patients are actually in our software? Roughly 5% of the US population is in our software today, with providers charting, billing for those patients. How many visits are happening in our software? Today we have 1.7 million patient appointments booked per month, almost 70 million appointments booked ever, and 20 million visits booked per year in the software. So if you take the number of appointments in Dr. Chrono, divide that by the number of appointments in the US, we're doing approximately 2.3% of the appointments booked across the United States. We do have the medical billing side, so we connect to all of the insurance companies as well. And when you connect to all of the insurance companies, you can process the claims. I showed you guys the HCFA 1500 form, that piece of paper that they submit. Well, you can actually do that digitally. So we submit claims to insurance companies. We're doing around 4.8 billion processed in medical bills per year. And then we're doing $11 billion in medical claims we've processed in total for the life of our company. I kind of want to go into this. I was reading a book on Toyota way back when, and it had a really interesting story about Toyota. And this is kind of the way I think about our company, and like, how do we get more mass adoption of software in the medical industry? And really the way that I look at it is, there's a Toyota car. Awesome cars. But they had a really good methodology that they used in the past where, and they still use it today, something called Kaizen. And they have a factory, factories all over the place. And essentially what they do is whenever there's like a defect or an issue on the line where they're building the cars, they stop the whole line. And then they bring everybody over to where that defect is. And then they all work on that defect together. That's why this company was so good for so long. They did something a lot of the other car industry was not doing. So Kaizen, what does the word mean? It means change is good. There's a lot of organizations out there that I would say resist change. That's a really bad thing. This is the definition. It's basically continuous improvement. Kaizen means continuous improvement. And this is software today. I would say if a company is doing yearly software releases, I'd be worried about your company. So if your company produces software and then builds for a whole nother year and then releases a year later, that's this model here. The way that I view software is the faster you do it, the more you can get feedback from the users, the faster you can build more product. So some companies do monthly releases. Some companies do weekly releases. And then there's companies that do daily releases. And then there's companies that do multiple releases per day. Now, there's a computer science word called continuous integration, where you can do multiple releases per day. This is what Dr. Chrono is doing. We can get it out to all of our users within minutes. I view software as something that's never fixed. And I think the companies that understand that their business models need to change over time are the most successful. I kind of view it like compound coding. If you could do multiple releases per day in your software, you get that feedback real time. Albert Einstein said this once. He said, the power of compound interest is the most powerful force in the universe. I would say remove compound interest in the universe and put it as the power of compound coding is the most powerful force in software development. So if you're able to release software multiple times a day, it's going to change a company over time. And also the speed of software development is accelerating across the industry. And this has to do with the tools that are coming out where developers can build faster and faster. So if you're waiting a whole year to do a software release and you have not gotten any feedback from the users in real time, that's a problem. We had one government, I'm not going to name the government, they came into our offices, they'd spent gobs of money on software, which they didn't release for multiple years, launched it, and the industry didn't use it. It fell apart. And if you get the feedback real time, it gives you an advantage as a company. And this is what people had told me and my co-founder when we first were thinking about starting our company. And this was a quote from many, many people. You can't compete with the incumbent EHRs. I actually think they're wrong. I think there are no examples, and maybe you could come up to me after this presentation, of large entities like SAP and Oracle. They tried to move down market. They weren't successful at moving down market. I don't know of large entities moving down market I have heard of entities moving up market successfully though. Like if you think of Microsoft, they weren't an enterprise company, but they became an enterprise company over time, so they moved up market. The same thing with Salesforce. They were able to build a product for a user, and they were able to like move into larger enterprises over time. So I think starting with smaller product is critical, and getting it to the user is critical, but going really large out of the gate is good if you can successfully sell it, but it's hard to go back down. Physicians also don't have money for very large installs, $50 million install of software. They just don't have that money. So multi-billion dollar markets, they're always going to get disrupted. Every company out there will get disrupted if you don't innovate and push the boundary of what you are doing. So this is a prediction. This is my prediction. You guys can tell me I'm wrong. But the prediction is on-premise software use is going to go down over time. And then cloud software use is going to go up over time. There'll be a period, and I would say we're in that period right now, where there's something called hybrid cloud solutions, where you have this hybrid of cloud and on-premise, they call it on-prem solutions. I actually think over time, people are just going to be moving to cloud. And this is just going to be over time. In the process of moving to cloud, we also need to think about design. We're all users here. The best products are designed with a lot of thought. I put a glass of water up here because it just works, right? Water just works. You just grab a glass, you drink out of it. A spoon just works, right? You want products that just are super, super simple. Glasses, you just throw them on. Sneakers, you just throw them on. These are things that like really don't get in your way. I'm gonna go into some data insights now. One thing I wanted to just talk about is the GDP. Does everybody know the GDP? Yes, no? Raise your hand if you do. Okay, it's like 50% of the room. The GDP is basically the way that we measure our whole entire country's economy by how much stuff we produce. The GDP of the United States today is $19 trillion, $19.4 trillion. That's roughly 15% of the US economy. How much did we spend on healthcare? $3.5 trillion is spent on healthcare of the United States GDP. So that's 17% of our spend is on healthcare. How many doctors are there in the United States? 1 million. But there's a lot of them that are taking vacations or retired. So we pull that down. There's less providers. These are MDs. These are not nurses. This is not acupuncturists. These are just working MDs in the United States. And these are just numbers I think about, like for market sizing and who are we going after as a company? Who should we all be going after, right? And these are pulled from various sources. So 54.5% of the visits in the United States are happening through primary care physicians. So that's roughly half of all patient encounters are going through the PCP. So what does that tell me? It just gives me some insight into what we should be building. The US population, a little over 300 million people in the US, okay? There's a lot more patient visits happening in the United States than there are people. These are little bits that I think about a lot when building my company. Here's another interesting chart. And I kind of care about this, right? I have a son. How much time does his provider actually spend with him? 5% is 9 minutes or less. 9 minutes, like what? How much can you get from a patient? Unless the medical information that's given to the doctor is really relevant and they can really determine before the patient walks in. Then there's 22% are 9 to 12 minutes. So it's not a big difference from 9. And then there's 13 to 16 minutes is 29%. And then the vast majority is, I think, a good amount of time, 17 minutes per patient. That's a good amount of time. But if the patient has like an aggressive disease, that may not be enough time. So again, it's how do you build software or medical devices or machine learning or any of these things? How do you give that doctor more time with more patients? And then 11% are spent over 25 minutes with the patient. So what drives the medical industry? If out of that spend of $3.5 trillion, roughly half of it, roughly, is spent on Medicare and Medicaid, what does that tell me to build? Half of what we spend in the US is on Medicare and Medicaid. So how do you determine what to build based off of this stuff, this data? And this is honestly what we think about at our company. Like, what do you do? Here are market sizes below. And these are all from different sources I pulled together. What's the biggest here? Kind of blew my mind. Telemedicine. The market projection for telemedicine is over $100 billion in telemedicine. In my mind today, I see it as a gold rush. It's like, who is going to get as much of that market as possible? It's really nice to be able to see a provider and not leave your home. These are other massive markets, and these are markets I think are all good. All of these markets are good. It's none of them are bad. It's a matter of where you're passionate and or what your company thinks is going to be a good market. Here's another one that's big. $70 billion market for revenue cycle management. Does anybody know what revenue cycle management is? Yes, raise your hand if you do. Half. The doctor doesn't want to do their billing. They want someone to take care of it and they give it to someone else. Our company does that. So you get the provider team, they come in and they say, hey, we want to do the best we possibly can for the patients. We don't want to hire a whole billing team in-house. It's expensive and they'll have to learn a lot. Can you please take all of my information, condense it into a HICPA 1500 form, and get me paid accurately? That's what RCM is. That's another big market. AI, machine learning, $30 billion market. These are all different data points to like point you in the right direction. I'm gonna go into the future a little bit now. I have a really optimistic view of the future. That's why I started a company. I feel like there's a lot we can do. Here's a fun photo from Star Trek. They know how to heal people with like really cool machines. And so, you know, this is a really bright future. And I think we're honestly heading in this direction. Here is a prototype app that we built on Google Glass as a company when Google Glass first came out. The concept, we gave it to a handful of little under 100 doctors, and they used this app. They had Google Glass, and they were charting with something on their head. They were able to take photos, and they were putting these photos into the actual medical record where they could actually use that information. And in real time, the providers could actually have someone charting on the other side for the provider. We coined this the wearable health record. And essentially, providers, when they're seeing patients, they don't want to hold anything. You want to just see the patient, take care of the patient, take care of them. But when you're moving from room to room, you want to know what patient you're going to be seeing. We said, let's put on Apple Watch a face, some information that's useful to the doctor about what patients are coming into their office. It was a success. Today we have a multitude of providers using a medical record on their wrist. So the wearable health record is real, and providers are actually using this type of thing today. And I would be happy if my provider knew my face, right? As sad as it sounds, we beat a lot of competitors because they don't have a face in their medical record. So when the patient comes in, they don't really know that that's the right patient. But we started building out more and more where this is becoming a full-on medical record on your wrist. I'm gonna talk about APIs a little bit. This was a slide I wrote, and I really believe that this is happening around us, whether your company is doing it or not. Because we're moving into the cloud, because all this data is on the cloud, the companies that are leveraging APIs, they have a massive advantage over companies that don't have APIs. Now, what is an API? I'm sure a lot of you guys hear that word API. What the heck is that word? It's just a URL. At the end of the day, remember when you first went to http.yahoo.com and you're like, oh my God, this is crazy. And you could like search, you could click on Yahoo and go through stuff, and then Google.com. That's all that an API is. It's just a URL. You send a URL out, then you get data back. That's it. If a company can do that, those are the companies that are going to be changing the world over time. And honestly, the philosophy for me, I believe fundamentally, you can't do everything as a company. Having an API allows you to really partner with other companies successfully. We should all honestly have companies that have like open data philosophies. Most medical record software today, I call it like a walled garden. All medical record companies should have APIs. APIs. A few years ago, our company was invited to the White House. This is a photo from my iPhone. President Obama and Joe Biden had a conference talking about APIs in healthcare. They pulled us in. There's Obama's dogs. I don't know if anybody noticed the person next to me, but there were a lot of EHRs there. A lot of EHRs that really are trying to create a URL-based, API-based future. It's a really, really bright future if we can get to that point. There are really bad APIs, and then there's really good APIs. I would say, out of all of this stuff listed here, I sat in a room with several EHRs, and for the first time I ever saw several EHRs working on fire. So there is a consistent effort year over year I've seen happen where a lot of EHRs in the industry are trying to move to APIs. And all that fire really is, it's an API, a URL. So if one company wanted to get data from another company, they could do that through this standard called FHIR. And it's just a spec to get that data. Now, what healthcare is today, it's really sad. I would say one API is like a fax. It's a pretty bad experience today where you get a piece of paper that's printed out. It's not a good experience. There's a sad known fact that I'm sure a few of you guys have heard of HL7. You know, I've heard other people in the industry say one implementation of HL7 is one implementation of HL7, which means that it doesn't really work with other companies. There's secure FTP happening all of the time. It's a really, really complex like thing to set up, and then it's not that scalable, and it's just not the best way to do it. So you want like a modern, RESTful API. FHIR is one of them. There's a file format called CCBA. I see that taking up in the industry quite a bit. This is how you can sign up for the Dr. Crono API. It literally is, you can get signed up and live within a matter of how fast you can type. Other EHRs don't have this. You sign up and you get right into the documentation. How awesome would it be if every product could do this? Where you could like have your developers do this. With our API, here's an example. This is QDoctor they built on our API. It took them 2 weeks. If a patient cancels an appointment, that's what they did right there, QDoctor will allow other patients to get a text. And essentially, whatever patient sees that text and responds first can book that appointment. Imagine not having your staff call to book. I've heard a statistic, 25% of appointments are canceled. How horrible is it to like try to book those appointments because the doctor needs to have that time filled? Here's another partner. And this company, all they're doing is scanning IDs, taking that data and placing it into the practice management software and the medical record. They built on the Dr. Chrono API. So you can scan an insurance card from an iPad or an iPhone. All the information is pulled out of that and placed right into the medical record, reducing the time for staff, where they don't have to type all that information in or take a photocopy and place it into a piece of paper. Here's another company. This company is called OutcomeMD. They built on our API. That's actually the company inside of our EHR. They basically allow doctors, when the patient walks out, it asks the patient some really simple questions when they leave. It sends them a text. It just says, how are you doing? And it's pretty sophisticated because it asks questions, but then you'll know how your patients are actually doing. And they built on the Dr. Chrono API as well. So it's a really fun time, I would say, where we see a lot of companies coming to us to build on an API. Here's another one right here. They are a telemedicine company. They are doing a single sign-on into Dr. Chrono, kind of like Facebook, where you sign into Facebook. They just authorize the app, they get in, and then they can do a telemedicine appointment. I do see telemedicine as a huge market. I think these guys are onto something. But basically, you have practice management software, which gives you a schedule of all the patients that are coming in, which is Dr. Chrono. We have an API. They just query the API, and they say, would you like to make this a telemedicine appointment? And they kind of do a look ahead to say, you know, what patients may want a telemedicine appointment. How awesome would it be if, say, someone is homebound, they're in a wheelchair, they have a broken leg, and a company can query an API and say, would you prefer to do a telemedicine follow-up appointment with your provider? It'd be awesome. Homebound patients, this is like a really good option for them. Here's another partner that built on our API. That is their app inside of our product. So we didn't want to go out and connect to all of the labs in the United States. We wanted a partner to go out that could do it. This company is called Health Gorilla. And Health Gorilla connects Dr. Chrono to every lab in the United States. They're basically ordering a lab right here. So we can basically have this complete product with what providers would like layered on top, pick the lab that they want to send the lab to, blood work to, and then one of our partners can help pick the lift up on like what that need is. Here's a clinical trial partner. Basically, in real time, they're querying the API to see if there's any patients. And this is their app inside of ours. But they're querying the API and pulling information about the patient saying, is this person relevant? Are they a fit for a clinical trial? The provider can hit submit. They wait about 48 hours. And then a report will come back to the provider saying they're a fit or they're not a fit. Generally with clinical trials today, what happens is they hire a person, a clinical trial expert, and then they have to spend all this time to like figure out, is this person a fit or are they not a fit? If providers can do all of this stuff and the staff can do all of this stuff through an API, it reduces the cost of the full GDP that we're spending in healthcare today. This was an email from a provider. He said, I want to use my iPad Pro. I want to use my stylus. Can you find me an app that actually can do handwriting recognition and place that into my medical record? The answer is yes. You can build anything as long as the two companies have APIs. Machine learning, so this is part of our future. I'll go through one machine learning slide. This is one of our partners, Ambra Health. They do not do machine learning, but I would say they build something that layers in to pull in DICOM images into the medical record. But what I wrote below is what's really important. So what normally happens is you have this machine, a DICOM machine that does like an EKG, any type of imaging, pulls it out, and then you have the radiologist review it. And then the radiologist sends the report back into Dr. Kono. In the future, I do see companies doing machine learning to reduce that cost drastically. If you look here, an experienced radiologist costs roughly $450,000 up per radiologist, but machine learning is getting so good, you may not have to pay the radiologist. It may be something that just every report would like immediately have this machine learning look at it, and it would just reduce the cost. Thank you guys all for attending the Rock Health Conference, and as to disease, make a habit of two things, to help or at least do no harm.